together. Good to see Sister Joanne Carver back with us. And thankful she's here tonight. Amen. Preacher Jack, would you take us to the Lord, brother, and pray for us?
Father, again, we want to thank you and praise your holy name for all you've done for us. We thank you, Father, for your revelation. We thank you, Father, for your faith. Father, we thank you for meeting the needs. Father, for what you're here for us. Bring faith to us tonight. Lord, we are thankful to you, Lord, for being our Savior. And Father, as you know, we've been here, Lord, we're sick. We thank you, Lord, for your tonight. Father, we thank you, Lord, for being in the hospital or home now. But Lord, we pray, Lord, for our hospital even right now, Lord. Give us some more patience than Father, we ask you to handle this, what you keep in it. We ask you to bless and be a church by the Lord. Happy New Year, in Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Amen. If you have your Bible, turn with me to Psalm 92, Psalm 1 and Psalm 92. Psalm 1 and Psalm 92. I would like to preach from both of these Psalms this evening. I'm going to do my very best to tie them together. But the Lord's help. Three Wednesdays ago, we started a series on building walls. We preached out of Jude 21 on building up yourself in the most holy faith to build the person that glorifies the Lord. And then last Wednesday, we preached from 1 Kings chapter number 6, where Solomon built the temple dedicated to God. And we preached on building a place that glorifies the Lord. And then this past Sunday, we preached from Matthew chapter number 7, verse 23 through 27, on the wise man and the foolish man, and one building his house upon the sand and one upon the rock. And we preached about having a firm foundation. And so we're continuing the thought of building and being planted and being rooted and growing. All right, the Bible says in Psalm 1, blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinners, nor sitteth in the seat of the scornful. But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law doth he meditate day and night. And he shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water, that bringeth forth his fruit in his season. His leaf also shall not wither, and whatsoever he doeth shall prosper. The ungodly are not so, but are like the chaff, which the wind driveth away. And therefore the ungodly shall not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the congregation of the righteous. For the Lord knoweth the way of the righteous, but the way of the ungodly shall perish. Psalm 92. It is a good thing to give thanks unto the Lord, and to sing praises unto thy name, O Most High, to show forth thy loving kindness in the morning, and thy faithfulness every night, upon an instrument of 10 strings, and upon the psaltery, upon the harp with a solemn sound. For thou, Lord, hast made me glad through thy work. I will triumph in the works of thy hands. O Lord, how great are thy works, and thy thoughts are very deep. A brutish man knoweth not, neither doth a fool understand this. When the wicked spring as the grass, and when all the workers of iniquity do flourish, it is that they shall be destroyed forever. But thou, Lord, art most high forevermore. For lo, thine enemies, O Lord, for lo, thine enemies shall perish. All the workers of iniquity shall be scattered. But my horn shalt thou exalt like the horn of a unicorn. I shall be anointed with fresh oil. Mine eyes also shall see my desire of my enemies, and my ears shall hear my desire of the wicked that riseth against me. The righteous shall flourish like the palm tree. He shall grow like the cedar in Lebanon. Those that be planted in the house of the Lord shall flourish in the courts of our God. They shall still bring forth fruit in old age. They shall be fat and flourishing to show that the Lord is upright. He is my rock, and there is no unrighteousness in him. Here in Psalm 1 and in Psalm 92, the Lord's given us the contrast between the wicked and the righteous. In short, the righteous love God, love the things of God, love the place of God, and love the Word of God. I believe the wicked, they hate God, they hate the things of God, they hate the people of God, and of course do not believe and trust in the Word of God. If any wicked person tries to do anything with the Word of God, usually they try to do that somebody that would take that and use it falsely. For instance, how many has ever heard of maybe somebody who did not believe in God, an atheist, agnostic, or something like that, and knew just enough of the Word of God? Maybe even I have met some that claim not to know the Lord, and Brother Jack knows so much of the Bible, probably know more scripture than some Christians, and the only reason, sister, that they know the scripture is trying to take a child of God and get them to fail and fall in their faith. And we know by Luke 19 that Zacchaeus, the rich man, had to climb up the poor man's tree to see Jesus. So that is a sign and a picture of humility. So we've preached about several different types of trees. And as I was reading these passages of Scripture and thinking about plants and thinking about trees, the Lord has begun to give me a few little thoughts. The righteous love the things of God. I've already said that. We will find from these two chapters, these two Psalms, that the righteous are faithful people, the righteous are faithful people, and the righteous are flourishing people. And I began to think about plants. How many have real plants living on the outside of the house? I know, Sister Patsy, they've got about a million there up there. I told somebody one day, Brother Jack, I said, who wants to go see the Rhododendron Festival on Rome Mountain? We can just go to Brother Jack and Sister Patsy's and see all that they plant. It's beautiful up there. They've got a lot of live trees, and they live right there in the middle of the woods. And they've got live plants and things of that nature. And probably everybody here has a little bit of landscaping. Maybe you've even got a live plant in a pot, maybe on the porch, or on a stand on the porch, or maybe even a live plant on the inside. But then you might even have some artificial plants on the inside of the house. We've got live plants and live trees on the outside of the church, but we have artificial plants and artificial flowers and artificial trees on the inside of the church. So I began to think about several kinds of plants. Before I get into the trees, I want to talk about plants and flowers, and I want us to think about ourselves as plants and trees tonight. I thought about special occasion plants. Now here in just a little bit, Sister Linda will probably be the one to get on the phone and order us some poinsettias. And we'll have poinsettias probably right here in front of the cross of here. And we'll probably have poinsettias. I'm going to say pine trees. We'll probably have poinsettias lying right across the stage, maybe right in the entranceway of the church, maybe right up there in the foyer. And so we put poinsettias out at Christmas time. And then at Easter time, we put lilies out. Well, some people are like poinsettias, and some people are like lilies. The only time you ever see them is at Christmas and Easter. I call them CEO Christians, Christmas and Easter only. And then you've got mourning boys, amen. And then you've got those that come on Mother's Day and Father's Day. And so, anyways, there's the special occasion plants. I'm glad tonight that I'm looking at some folks that ain't special occasion plants. And then there's artificial plants. Listen, you don't have to enlist unless you just, really went to town and pulling this thing apart. You can't really hurt it. It is not alive. This is a plant. This is a tree that's dead. It has no life to it. It is not rooted in any system. You don't have to keep it watered. You don't have to put any kind of plant food in it to keep it alive. This thing right here is not alive. These flowers right here are not alive. The plant here and over there and right there and right there, they're not alive. They might have a form of life in looking at it. And maybe somebody come in that's never been here and sit up in the balcony one Sunday morning and think, boy, the plants are pretty here at this church. And they might even for a second think that they're real, but they're not real. They're artificial. They have no life. There's a lot of people that are walking through life, and even people in our churches today who we might think are believers and have been born again and have life in Jesus, but they're just like the artificial plant. They are not rooted. They are not grounded. And Lord, they're dead. And then I thought about not on the special occasion plants, not on the artificial plants, but then I thought about pot plants. I asked Brother Greg, I asked him if he could bring this tree up here for me from my office. I can take this and I can move this right. It don't take nothing. This was a little odd. And a big old gust of wind could come by and blow that thing off.
Cynthia and Daryl and Don, they worked on our Thanksgiving decorations, our fall and harvest decorations at the house, and they got water shocked up and baled the hay, and we got some pumpkins and some mums and things to decorate, but a big old gust of wind, they got it anchored down by a big post and by a big tomato thing, and I mean, but a big old gust of wind comes off that hill behind the house, and Brother Ross, it don't take nothing to blow that fodder shock down, but it ain't really rooted in the ground like a real tree or something is.
She come out, she's a little groggy, you know, they give you that, I don't care, Lisa. Amen.
She come out, just had her arm in that sling. Said, I'm going to have surgery. Just popped it in place. And if I'm not mistaken, Sister Jennifer is that next Sunday morning. She come in and have that thing on. I said, Carly, how are you? What's going on? She said, doctor said I'd only have to wear it if I needed it. Thanksgiving Day. Everybody wait on Black Friday. I'm against Black Friday, but I'm getting it. Well, I don't want to get in trouble. I've got family, Mom, that can't wait to get their turkey. I can almost jump on a turkey leg. Amen, because they can't wait to get to Kmart. Amen, to get the sales on Thanksgiving Day. What's ever happened? I'm going to just say it right before Thanksgiving. Being thankful for what we do have, amen. Instead of being so greedy, we don't need to give what we don't have. Amen. I'm preaching all of us tonight. Man alive ought to be thankful. Is everybody okay? That wasn't in my notes. I'm going to move on. Slip to your notes, preacher. I believe we ought to be thankful. By the way, enjoy a trunk tree. Dress up if you want to, have your candy and all that. Then enjoy Thanksgiving. Enjoy the pilgrims, the Indians, your cranberries, your pumpkin pie. I plan on eating about 10 turkeys and 15 pumpkin pies and all that stuff. Hallelujah. I might not eat 15 pumpkin pies, but I might have 13. But enjoy and being thankful. And being faithful and then also being happy. Plan verse number 4. For thou, Lord, hast made me glad through thy work. I will triumph in the works of thy hands. I tell you, we ought to be the happiest people in all the world.
Amen.
Amen. They're protected plans. Verse number 9. For lo thine enemies, O Lord, for lo thine enemies shall perish. All the workers of iniquity shall be scattered. You know, Brother Teddy, I do my best to try to. You know, I've done a little landscaping, but everything I know from getting help from mother-in-law, dad-in-law, Brother Mike come to help me plant a few hydrangeas three years ago. My man Mom's helping. Brother Jack, Brother Ariel's giving me some advice along the way. Brother Eric, Brother Jason have given me some advice. My neighbor Troy, he's given me some advice. And we've got knockout roses. Brother Troy talked to me the other day. He said, preacher, I'm going to tell you how you can protect those from the first frost. You know, I thought about that. I'm glad that the Lord, if we are rooted and planted in Him, I'm glad that no matter what storm comes our way, the cold times of life come our way, I'm glad that He's able to cover us and protect us. Praise the Lord. And then fruitful plants. I mean, the Lord's even able. Daryl, we've almost went to war with them things, ain't them moles. The Lord is able to keep moles out of the problem. I'm going to go as far one day, Brother Arnold, and see if cats can get me a tank or something. I'm going to blow the ground today. To get rid of them moles. I know there's people thinking, boy, if Rick and Nathan could get a hold of a tank, he would. Oh, man. Everybody's got that in mind, right? The kind of vision with me riding through the top of the tank with an army helmet on. That'd be great. All right. Faithful plan, happy plan, protective plan. What about a fruitful plan? Verse 14. They shall bring forth fruit in old age. They should be fat and flourish. We ought to be fruitful. We ought to be fruitful. Every one of us. And then also be satisfied. They shall bring forth fruit in old age, they shall be fat and flourishing to show that the Lord is upright. Now, that's a few things about being planted and being plants, but now I want to give you just a few things from Psalm 1. this is probably even a more known and memorized psalm than Psalm 92. A lot of people have Psalm 91 memorized and Psalm 93. Some in 92, it is sometimes forgotten that. So again, we're talking about the righteous and we're talking about the wicked. Now about the path of the righteous man. The righteous man doesn't believe like the world believes. The righteous man doesn't behave like the wicked behaves. The righteous man doesn't belong with the world. That's our path. We believe different, we behave different, we belong to a whole other world. Not this world, but to heaven. Praise God. And then also I think about the pleasure. The Bible says, blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of another, nor standeth in the way of the sinners, nor sitteth in the seat of the scornful, but his delight is in the law of the Lord. And in his law doth he meditate day and night. I think about his pleasure. I believe a person that is right, that is righteous and rooted, and is built upon a firm foundation, and has been planted by God, I believe he loves the Word of God. And 1 Peter 2:2, he tells us that it's built for a baby. And Hebrews chapter number 5, verse 12, 13, 14 tells us that it's meat for those that are growing. In John 6, 51, it's the bread of life for everyone. The Bible tells us in Psalm 19, 10 that it's honey for those in need. The Bible likens it to a hammer and a mirror and a rock and a fire and a sword. I thought about going ahead and getting in on some of that, but that's that, Lord willing, to go in another message here in a few weeks whenever God lets me. But there's the path, there's the pleasure, but then I'm going to give you the position. And I've got about six things that I'm going to give you on the position. All right? This all goes right along with being planted. All right? The Bible says that he shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water. He is positioned next to a life source. I'm thankful that we are positioned in the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Rooted and grounded in the chief cornerstone. I mean, I preached a message about 8 years ago on staying close to the one that's called you. I'm thankful that it's called us and saved us and blessed us and equipped us. And he is the living water. He is the river of life. He told the woman. He told the woman, Scott, in John chapter number 4, the woman at the well. He said, once you get a taste of the water that I give, he said, there'll be a spring of living water coming up out of your soul. I want to be planted. I want to be planted right there, close to the life source. Not only do I see the position, but I see the prominence. The Bible says that he shall be like a tree. Now, I'm not real smart, but I can tell that this tree is taller than this. And this tree is higher than that. And this tree, I don't know, it might be even with that over there, but it's still just a tad. Is that a tad? Yeah. It's still a little taller than that, and it's taller than that. The Lord wants us to be like a tree. They talk about those trees, those redwood trees, that are so big, Dad, that are so wide, that they've got tunnels going, that you can drive a car right through the middle of a tree. Is that the redwood forest? I believe, I want to say that in California, I may be mistaken. But I mean, they talk about those trees are so big and so strong that the root system runs for miles. And said the root system ties in with another root system of this tree, and with another root system of this tree, and another root system of that tree. And what has made them so strong is they're being supported and encouraged and strengthened by one another. I'm glad that they're strengthened from above, they're strengthened from below, and they're strengthened from those that are around. How many is glad that we're strengthened from the one above? I'm glad that we're anchored in Jesus, amen, which goes downward, but I'm glad that we can be strengthened by those that are around us. Amen. That's the position, that's the prominence. Then I think about the permanence, the plan. They talk about the palm trees. Ashley Crenshaw, a good friend of mine, had to take her oldest son down to a children's hospital in Florida for some tests. They've been in Jacksonville the last 3 days. And I called her today check in with Mom Axel, D.H. and Mildred's granddaughter in law. And so, Brady's wife. And so I called, I said, just want to check in on little Brady. She's giving me the report, and I said, where are you right now? It sounds busy. She said, well, he felt good enough to go to the Cheesecake Factory. Amen. I said, have a piece of cheesecake for me. She said, we might eat two. Amen. And you know what? I thought she has posted on Facebook pictures of the damage up there through Jacksonville. They got up there on the, are those sisters called the North Beaches, I believe, up there around Jacksonville? And anyway, there's this big propane tank that was one, I mean, just out there in the middle of the sand. And homes where the foundation, you know, those big old posts and things have been moved. And how hard the storms have been. And I've even went back and seen pictures and videos of the hurricanes that would take a lot of trees right up from around us and pull them up. But those palm trees are so strong and so rooted that they bend, Brother Kent, all the way down the ground. And they do not snap. That's why the Lord has likened us into the palm tree. No matter how strong the storm is, no matter how hard the wind is, it might bust you all the way over to the ground, but it will not break you. Hallelujah. The position, the prominence, the permanence, and then also the productivity. And this can even go back to Psalm 92:14. We ought to be fruitful. Amen? Not barren, but fruitful. It brings forth fruit. And then, you know, I believe we could even say this, the predictability of the tree. We know that at a certain time of season, if everything stays right, Brother Darrell, that you get enough cool weather, and I mean, I'm not Mark Reynolds, but I guess if you get enough dampness and rain and coolness and all that, in time, if you get more of the right stuff, the strong winds, the trees are going to change colors. Red and orange and yellow and all that. Beautiful. Fall is my favorite time of year. I love it. And then, should it continue on, it's going to get colder, and they're going to come off the tree, the leaves are, and the leaves are going to dry out, and then crush them up. Some people use them as mulch and things of that nature. But you know, after the cold spell, after the cold spell, the springtime's coming, and then life comes back into those trees. The trees out here are not super beast mode trees. They're not constantly producing fruit all the time, berries all the time, they've got their seasons. Those trees, those plants, all those things, they've got their times that they rest. And then after they rest and they lay dormant, don't they come alive and they come forth with fruit and they bud and they blossom? Listen, you might not always be a fruitful. And there's going to be times that you have to rest. There's going to be times that you just have to step back and spend time with God. But in those dry season, if you work and are fruitful in God, won't you? I'm telling you, if you sow and plant, harvest time is coming.
Amen.
And you can be productive and you can be the predictability. But then I think about the prosperity. This is the last one. He shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water, bringing forth his fruit in his season. His leaf also shall not wither, and whatsoever he doeth shall prosper. I want to be planted and rooted and grounded, and I want to try to grow, and I want to try to be fruitful, and I don't want to be barren, and I want to prosper for the glory of God. I believe our church is prospering. I believe the people of this church are prospering in the middle of a country that is not. Yeah, the world outside may. Can I just tell you? I don't know if you watch the news or whatever, but when you've got Vladimir Putin calling for all of the delegates and the representatives of Russia to come home. See how many remembers about 4 minutes ago I preached about ambassadors, and I preached about before
country goes to war, they call their ambassadors home. Now, I don't know what's going on, Brother Jack. I don't know all that. I don't get to follow it. I can't just stay home 24 hours a day and have my eyes glued to the TV. I wouldn't want to do that anyways. That'd drive me crazy. But when you get news about, Sister Alicia, Ralph Sexton, a text message. I said, well, make sure that this is, that's credible, that it's saying there's something, that this is happening. He says, yes, Vladimir Putin has sent out a message to call the workers, ambassadors, not mother, God, name, delegates, dictator, whoever. These people represent to come home. I don't know why. But I mean, I'm going to tell you what, we're in a dry spell, in a cold spell spiritually all over America, in this world. But boy, I'm looking in the middle of deadness. I see a whole lot of trees and plants that have been planted and that are growing and that are flourishing and prospering for the Lord. Jesus Christ, you've been good listeners tonight. With everything done and now closed, I just want to ask you this. This is how I'm going to do it tonight. This is how I'm going to do the invitation. If you just want to come tonight and pray around the altar and ask the Lord to help you to be fruitful and to be prosperous and to be productive and to be what God wants you to be, I invite you to come. Lord Jesus, we love you. Thank you, Lord, for your word. Thank you, Father, for planting us in this place. And Lord, thank you for your power to be prosperous and productive in these last days. Lord, I want to be a productive Christian. Lord, I want to do what's right as an individual. Lord, I want my wife to do what's right. I want my daughters. I want my family. As for me and my house, we'll serve the Lord. Lord, I desire for everybody here to be rooted and grounded and grow in Jesus and to be productive and prosperous for your glory. And Lord, we desire that for our church. And Lord, that we do more and not less and be more until the day that you call us home. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's stand together. And if you feel led, just come and pray around the altar. And I will take you to the homes. And again, we say this also during invitation. It might be, not during invitation, but during prayer request. You know, some people can't get down to the altar. Some can't even, it's hard for them to even walk up and get in the pew. Wherever you're at, make that place an altar and talk to the Lord. Just want to give you just a few little short minutes to pray to God and ask Him to go. I'll say this. Maybe you just need to take this opportunity wherever you're at to just thank Him. Just tell Him that you love Him. Tell Him you're thankful for Him and for what He's given you. Lord, we're blessed, thank you. We're blessed. I don't want to just wait down to November the 20th, whenever Thanksgiving is, 24th, 25th, whatever day that is. I'm not going to just wait then to get around and thank Him. I'm thankful. How many loves Him tonight? Can we give Him just a big hand clap of praise tonight?
Do we have any announcements?
About 7:00 tonight. Please continue also to remember Garrett's sister and brother-in-law's family. I don't know what the services are for that, for Brother Henry. Sister Christie, help him out Saturday, but we're going on. 5:15, be here, less than 5:30, after the police have suffered, and this will have to be a campus. I've got some, do you remember Fish, or that Fish Brown, the Friday, the first, I believe, I'll have that recorded. I've got several announcements coming in. And also, when you come, I think they all look in this week's morning, we've got some measure. So when you come in Sunday, Brother Taz is going to have a screen, some extra announcements that probably will not be in the board. So we're aware of that, of the screen Sunday, okay? And we'll try to let them know this a little bit before we go out to service. We'll probably have Sunday school to 10:30 like we do, and begin worship at 10:45, like we have last year. Okay, so let's remember that. It's been good to be in the Lord's house. Darrell, I love you. Send both of you, this is.
God, thank you, God, all you done, all you do, God, so good to us, God, bless us so highly. We thank you for that, God, Father, I'm hoping, God. God, help us to be good lights, God. Help us grow up, God, for glory and honor, God, I pray. Help us remember what we heard tonight, God, take it to you, God, I pray. Be better people, dear God, better Christians, better servants. Dear God, I pray, give me what I've built, dear God. Help me overcome my temptations, God, I pray.